I'm Kyle, and welcome back to another episode of Depreciation Nation. I'm joined by my friend Derriff today, who's a member of our nation and does a lot of things behind the camera to ensure that we have organization, we'll call it. But today I wanted to do a video and discuss the pendulum of depreciation, which is what I talk about relatively commonly in these videos that we produce, and Derriff's going to join me here so that we can just have a conversation about this. But essentially the pendulum of depreciation starts here when the car is new, swings down here to when the car is fully depreciated. And then for collector cars like Porsche, BMW, Corvettes, Mercedes, of course, we go from that fully depreciated state, we start to swing back up the other way. So a large part of what we do on this channel is we try to catch these cars at the point that the depreciation pendulum is hanging straight down. And so a lot of the projects that we've been working with and a lot of the things that we have in store for you are based on cars that could not be purchased any cheaper than they are right now. So we're gonna talk about the cars that we have, we're gonna talk about some of the projects that we have coming up, we're gonna talk about some of the things that you can look forward to, and then we're gonna talk about the terrible decisions we have made and the misses that we have made on cars that we should have purchased, thinking that they were going to depreciate just a little bit more than they did, and I was terribly wrong. So Derriff, what are the cars that you remember growing up and the cars that first pop into your mind and the it cars, the kind of cars that made an impression on you?
Well, the first car that I fell in love with was a 92 Honda Accord.
Nice.
Reason being, my uncle had one, and to me, it was just elegance at that time. You know, it was a black car, tan interior, state of the art for the time. And I mean, I grew up in Jamaica, and when you have a Honda Accord at that time, it was magnificent, you know. So I fell in love with that car. I do remember a friend of mine, his dad drove a Volvo. It was in the 80s, so if I tell you the exact year, I would be lying. But that car also, it left a mark on me, because to me, that was the first car of note that had luxury in it.
And a Volvo.
Yeah. And I think Volvos are excellent.
We love the Volvo.
I love Volvos. I mean, I've never thought of buying one, but every time I sit in one, it makes me wonder, why haven't I got one? Mm-hmm. You know, but that was about the Accord was the first one. The Volvo brings back good memories. I'm an Audi guy. Mm-hmm. And the two cars that I've lusted after was a Porsche and an Audi. Until I had a ride in the Taycan, I've never experienced a Porsche before. But I do remember the first time I drove an Audi. It was a 2004 Audi A4 stick shift. I won't tell you why I had to drive that Audi. The person's Audi who I had to drive might not appreciate that story. But that A4 left a mark on me where I was like, that's on my bucket list. Mm-hmm. I had to get an A4 before I got, like, that was my ultimate car at that point, mm-hmm. you know, and it had to be.
But stick. It still is.
It still is.
Yes.
It still is. In fact, it's going to be one of our projects now. Mm-hmm. So the Audi A4 is my car, mm-hmm. you know. It was a black Audi A4 that I had to drive for that gentleman, and the funniest thing, I remember sitting in that car with my sister, you could say, and I couldn't even start the car. I didn't remember. I was so excited about sitting in this car, so simple yet so elegant, that I didn't even know how to start a car. I sat there for a while and then started driving it, and what hooked me was that it was a driver's car.
Right.
It was so responsive. I felt like if I thought about doing something, the car just responded to me. It fit me like a glove. Mm-hmm. And I was determined on having that car. I've had other cars after that. They were great, but the lust I had for that Audi never left.
And that's the way that it's been for me with the E46 platform. The experience that I had at 20 years of age in a car that, of course, I couldn't afford,
exactly.
That was responsive, and it felt like it fit me, and it was analog, and the way that it reacted to turning and the power that it had, even though it pales in comparison to today's numbers.
It was the it car.
I would take that car any day over any of today's cars, and as I've said many times, I have taken that car over many of the it cars. So, what was your first car?
My first car was a 91 Honda.
Nice.
I was determined on getting that experience. Loved that car. It didn't have the look that I wanted it to have because, you know, I wanted that exact car that my uncle had.
Right.
You know, but I was very happy with my car. Mm-hmm. In fact, when I had that car was when I started talking to my wife. So we have a very special connection with that car. You know, and I would get that car again just because.
Right.
You know, but it was a 91 Honda LX charcoal, and loved it.
Interesting story. I learned how to drive in a 1992 Mercury Topaz that was also charcoal.
Oh, wow.
And we, at the time, my family drove cars 200,000 miles when cars didn't go 200,000 miles. And the fact that both my brother and I learned how to drive in that car, it's just mesmerizing that it went 222,000 miles because as a young person, you can imagine our foot was on the floor every time we had a chance. So the fact that that car continued to hold together after all of that, but again, just like you, I'd have that car again just because.
Yes. Now, I'm not a big American car fan as far as a lot of the stuff they had in the 90s, you know, it just didn't appeal to me, right? Mm-hmm. But there was on my block, this was a Firebird, Pontiac Firebird, and it had fat tires in the back. And I said, at that point, I didn't even see smoking. Mm-hmm. That's a cool car.
That's awesome.
You know, and I remember it had some orange in it. It had a plethora of colors, but... predominantly there was some orange in it, and it still had the Firebird on the hood.
Right.
And I'm like, man, it was a piece of crap. It needed work. Mm-hmm. And that's when I really started to watch car shows and all of that stuff and you know, form a love for the engineering aspect. But I got two left hands and all thumbs, so I can't do nothing but just watch and appreciate.
But we're working on that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We're changing the thumbs to fingers. But I wanted that car. Mm-hmm. I wanted to put a big block in it, and I wanted a blower on top. I had no idea what a blower did. Mm-hmm. It was all about the looks, you know. It didn't even matter. Mm-hmm. It was fake. I just wanted a blower on top. And I'm like, you know, that would be pretty cool. That's something I wanted. And, you know, hopefully we could work on something like that. But it can't be in the 90s, can't be in the early 2000s. It has to be that old 60s, 70s, you know. Body style. I love that body style. It's a very manly car, aggressive car. Mm-hmm. But I can't say that I would stay true to the leaf springs and everything.
Right.
I want something that could handle the type of power that I would love.
Some sort of a resto mod.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
My first car was a string of BMWs. It's honestly, it's difficult to pinpoint one. Mm-hmm. The reason it's difficult to pinpoint one is because my brother actually started the craze. My older brother bought a 1984 318 in 1996, and again we learned to drive in a 1992 Mercury Topaz, and so it was a manual transmission and it was rear wheel drive, and it was amazing to young people, and it was faster than all get out to young people, and it was in reality quite slow, but you couldn't have told us any. So that 1984 E30 led to our dad buying a 1986 735, which was an E23. And now we went from the 1.8 liter to the 3.5 liter venerable six cylinder, which again, by today's standards, was very, very slow, but for... Exactly, and so for me, I was like, I was on top of the world because we had this cool old luxury car, and again, we bought it with the Pendulum swinging straight down. I think my dad paid $2,300 for it or something like that. Sold it for less, of course. We still had it now.
We It's a classic.
I would consider that to be a miss. And so while I'm on the subject of misses, let me talk about all the cars that I thought were going to get cheaper and I messed up. So, Porsche 944, in 2001, you could buy them for between $1,000 and $1,500.
Really?
I thought I could ride that wave. It was one of the cars that I always intended to get, but that I had never quite gotten, and now they're $8,000, $9,000, $10,000, $16,000 for a low mileage car. So I missed the ride on that one.
I thought about getting the 350Z.
I think we can still do that because the pendulum isn't quite straight down yet.
No, it's not straight down, it's going back up.
It is going back up.
It's going back up. And I mean, the first one I drove was a stick shift red 350Z. Buddy of mine let me drive his car, and I was driving in Brooklyn. And I haven't driven a stick in years, so it shut off on me 3 times in the middle of traffic. But I got it moving. And boy, from block to block, it was fun. Mm-hmm. By the time you get to third gear, time to pump the brakes. But I'm like, man, this is a pretty cool car. You know, I would love to get something like this. And I just didn't do it, you know. Mm-hmm. I guess life got in the way. And
it stayed.
Yeah, that one sat right there, you know. What else? What did I miss? There really isn't a lot of misses. I guess I was so family focused that I just got what I needed for the family. I really didn't start thinking about myself. I can tell you how I got my first Audi, and the disappointment it was, but it really awoken a dragon inside, you could say, you know, that I must get more. We had a Nissan Murano, and I was deployed, and told my wife, when we come back, we're getting an Audi. Mm-hmm. She's like, yeah, no, like, we're getting an Audi. And unfortunately, she was in an accident in a few months. She got T-boned and messed the Murano up. Love the Murano. Mm-hmm. It's a great vehicle.
My dad has one of those now.
Oh, it's a great vehicle. Mm-hmm. Great vehicle. I would get it again.
He would agree with you.
I would get it again. And I went out and looked for an Audi. And I got a black 2006 A6 with a 4.2 liter.
Nice.
At 300 plus horsepower, they lied. It's way more powerful. And it was just elegance and luxury. Mm-hmm. And she's like, it's your turn to buy a car that you want. Mm-hmm. And she sat in that car the first day. She drove that car. She came home and she's like, you need to buy yourself a car. You're not getting back this one. And ever since that, we've been on an Audi craze. Nice. So now we've had one black, two grays, and a white. So we're on our fourth.
Nice.
And hopefully, we have three down there. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, we.
He lives down the street, by the way.
Yeah. hopefully that S4 is in my future. Before I bought the A4, I had, I was seriously thinking about getting an S4. I had the money for it, and a friend of mine told me it's not working in New York City. I think it was a smart call at that time, but I still have regrets on that one. I should have gotten it, you know. But who knows?
So
it's not out of the plans.
Another one of my misses was in 2001. The E30 M3 has absolutely skyrocketed in price. Mm-hmm. That was another car I thought I could ride the wave out on. Never dreaming that these cars were going to get to a point where one just sold at auction. Granted, it was pristine, and granted, it was very low mileage, but we just had one sell at auction for $250,000,
wow,
which set the new bar for what the car was worth. It's a fantastic car. I don't know that it's worth $250,000 to me.
Well, to somebody it is.
Obviously.
You know, the thing is with these cars is that they grab your heart and mm-hmm. you never let it go. Mm-hmm.
Well, this grabbed my heart. This definitely grabbed my heart because I had an opportunity to buy one in 2001 for $5,200. It had less than 100,000 miles on it. Mm-hmm. It was, I can't, I can't think of the specific name, but basically it was seal gray with red interior.
Wow.
I can see it like it was yesterday. And
must be pretty. Seal gray with
red. Oh my god, it was beautiful. Cardinal red. Wow. That car really sticks out to me. So I missed the E30 M3. I missed the 944. I missed a lot of cars thinking I could ride that wave out. The current cars that I think are fully depreciated, or at least what we are looking at, are the mid-2000s BMWs that I couldn't afford when I was in college.
Right.
And most people couldn't afford.
No, I remember those BMWs. I thought they were awesome.
The mid-2000 Saabs, the mid-2000 Mercedes.
Yes.
We took a trip to the Pull Apart a few weeks ago, and I had mentioned the E55 AMG that was on the cover of Car and Driver that
yes.
a tuning company had built.
That's just when they started to change from the square body
right.
to the more curvy body.
Right, and this car had been painted in a Porsche-specific color and was sitting on the AMG monoblock wheels, and it was very low. And one of the things I remember in the article was that when this car was on the banks, it would actually hit the bump stops on the suspension, because that's how much downforce this car generated.
I remember a gentleman from my church driving the Mercedes from Ghana. Mm-hmm. Absolutely loves Mercedes. Yeah, he had an old diesel one, mm-hmm. and he bought himself a white Mercedes. This was back in 96, 97. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember exactly what year it was, I don't remember the model, but I remember sitting in there and I felt like I had an air of superiority with mm-hmm. everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, a Mercedes, I wanted an E350. Didn't matter the year at the time, I just wanted one, because there's something about sitting in a Mercedes that's like, kind of feel like you made it.
Right.
You know, and
I've had that experience myself.
Yeah. Yeah. You sit in one. Shoot, I'll send the passenger side. They got me. But yeah, there's something about a Mercedes. I mean, I guess it's the ultimate car, right? Mm-hmm. Most people's standards, but there's something about Mercedes that just make you feel like you've made it. But it didn't capture my heart the way I would say Audi did, mm-hmm. but it definitely captured my attention.
Mm-hmm. So the current cars. I've got a 2000 BMW, which you've seen. I've got a 2004 Saab, which you haven't seen. My son's got a 2003 Saab that you haven't seen. You've got the 2006 A4 2.0 six-speed manual, which you haven't seen.
Right.
And to be quite honest, if you drive by our houses right now, it looks like we were doing really well for ourselves around 2004, 2005. Cars are great.
Yeah.
The projects are going to be fun. We've got two vehicles right now that will drop over the next few weeks, and their issues are so interesting, I have no idea what's wrong. But we will get to the bottom of that.
Yeah.
As far as future cars, and as far as cars that we're looking for, and as far as cars that fit the definition of our channel right now, the first gen Porsche Boxster certainly fits that description. The Pendulum is straight down on those cars. Obviously good examples can be had for about $6,000.
Yeah.
Poor examples can be had for $4,000, and I'm going to hazard the guess that if I show up with cash, they can be had for less. Cayennes are at the bottom. First gen Cayennes are at the bottom of their depreciation. E46 bodies are at the bottom. The E90s are starting to creep down, actually.
Really?
Mm-hmm. My miss with selling was I had an E36 M3 and I loved that car, and I sold it for a portion of a down payment on a home. And the Pendulum was hanging straight down when I sold that car. And while I sold it for decent money and everything worked out, the miles, the condition, the cleanness, that'd be a $25,000 car all day long today. And so that Pendulum is creeped back up the other side. All E30s are back up, all E36s are back up, and right now the E46 is, it's hanging straight down. You are never going to be able to buy one this cheap ever again.
Mm.
It's a solid car. It's got, it's the last of the analog cars really that BMW made, and certainly the 325 and the 330s are not half as exciting as the M cars. But not everybody can afford M cars, not everybody can afford the maintenance on M cars, and there's not a day that goes by that I don't enjoy my $300 E46. So
$300 I'd enjoy it too.
Exactly, exactly. So yeah, Cayennes, Boxsters, potentially the next generation of BMW or in the future. 2010 to 2012 Chargers with the V6 in them, which apparently was afflicted with a malady of issues. Mm-hmm. You can buy those non-running every day of the week for $2,000, and you've still got a solid platform that's got some modern content. You can throw a V8 in there relatively simply, wrap the car, and you've got something that looks just as modern as something that people can buy now.
Wow.
I'm going to say that poor condition C4 Corvettes, while they're less desirable than the C5s and C6s, C7, and of course the current C8, they're still a decent package. There was one on Facebook Marketplace not that long ago for $700, and of course it needed some work, but it ran and drove, and the idea that you can buy a Corvette that runs and drives for $700 is, well, it's intriguing to me. Other cars that fit this right now or fit our description of full depreciation would be that Mercedes E350 that you talked about. Mm-hmm. 2005s, there have been a few that have crept up that need some mechanical work that could be bought for $1,000. Still looks relatively modern. The interior is relatively modern.
It has a classic look.
They age well.
Yeah, it just never goes out of style.
They
That's
age
what
well.
I love about it.
There was a 2001 S550, not S550, an SL, SL500, my apologies. 2001 SL500 on Marketplace just a few weeks ago. Again, had a few issues, but it had the hard top and it had the soft top. The soft top was new. Needed some maintenance done to it, but that car could be bought for $1,800.
CLKs.
And SLKs.
Yeah.
The
I was more
hard top.
A CLK guy more than an SLK. The SLK was too small, but I had love for it.
Right.
But man, I remember a buddy of mine bought a CLK. This was back in 2005, 2006, and it was a pretty cool car. I couldn't wait to drive it.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, I love CLKs.
I rode in a 1997 Z3 with a 2.8-liter inline six-cylinder in it when they came out. With a salesperson, mm-hmm. and that car made just the biggest impression on me. I'd love to have one of those. I don't know where we are with that car right now because prices are a little all over the map. They can be bought for $1,000 as a mess, and they can be bought for $7,000 with low miles. That's a car that might just fluctuate both ways on our scale of depreciation. But
Toyota Supra.
Well, we might have missed it on that one.
Yeah, Toyota Supra.
Yes.
My first
Lexus IS.
Yeah. First experience with a Toyota Supra. My godmother's son. Mm-hmm. He's a Toyota Lexus fanatic. Mm-hmm. And first car he had, I remember him having, was a Honda Prelude, a red Honda Prelude, 91. Mm-hmm. That was just a fun car.
You missed the boat on those too.
Yes. Yes. That was a fun car. And then after that, I remember him telling me, I'm saving up to buy a Supra. At that time, I didn't know what a Supra was.
Right.
You know, I was a young kid. And then I saw that car, and then I drove in that car, and I was blown away. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, man, this is a pretty cool car. It was heavy. You could mm-hmm. feel the weight, but it just sat, and it just rocketed.
That is awesome.
And yeah, I would, just for the nostalgia, you know, I don't know if I would be able to control it. I'll get
a Supra. Lexus IS is still out there. First gen IS 250s and 350s. Actually, now that I say that out loud, I can't remember if the 250 came out initially. I think the 250 came out later as a less expensive option.
Yeah.
The IS 300, powered by a variant of the Supra engine that we're talking about. I believe so.
Yeah.
I believe so.
I'm not 100% sure, but let us know.
So,
as we move forward with this, we've talked about some of the projects we'd like to see. What we would love to hear is some of the projects that you would like to see. Sky's the limit, as we're still fresh and we're still new, but we're looking to build some very interesting content for y'all to watch out there. So if you like what you've seen, I hope that you comment, like, subscribe, perhaps hit that bell notification to join our nation, and I hope you join us again soon. Thanks.